to you. Happy birthday to you.
On my 43rd birthday, I was on vacation in Florida, celebrating with my wife, Toni-Joy, and family. Moments after the party, I received a phone call that changed our lives forever. Peanut's story actually begins with Nicole, Toni-Joy's sister. On February 27th, 2020, after a years-long battle with anorexia and other ailments, Nicole passed away, leaving us way too soon. Now, Toni-Joy and I had been talking about getting a dog for quite some time, but the plan was to wait until Bonnie, our elderly cat, left us. Due to her declining health, we didn't think it would be very long. But when Nicole died, I wanted to cheer up my grieving wife. So I suggested that we go look, just look, at some dogs. At the time, we were living in the San Francisco Bay Area. So we went to the Hayward Animal Shelter. And that's where we met this guy, whom the shelter had named Clyde. We thought that was funny since we had Bonnie at home. That's not why we liked him. He was small, quiet, graying at approximately age 6, and walked with a noticeable limp. During our meet and greet, his legs were shaking. Not trembling, but shaking, like a cowboy quaking in his boots. Somehow, he managed to make it over to Toni-Joy's lap. Anyone who looked at this dog would have simply seen a broken-down old chihuahua. But we saw our son. A few days after filling out the paperwork, we picked him up from the vet, where he had been neutered, and we brought him home in the cone of shame. At first, Bonnie was curious about this new character, before choosing to keep her distance. And for the dog, that was just fine, because he was still afraid of everything. He didn't even want to eat until we started coaxing him with peanut butter, which is how he got his name, Peanut. After a few days, we began to see a gradual improvement. We quickly gave him nicknames like Gooby, short for Goober, Ha Ha, Baby, and Buddy, before they morphed into Bubby. Little did we know that Peanut would soon become our pandemic dog. We took him everywhere with us. One of the things we loved about Peanut was his howl. Any kind of siren would set him off. So, we made a recording of him howling, and then we played that recording back to him to see if he'd howl again. And he did. And it was glorious. When Bonnie passed away, we decided to get another dog so that Peanut would never be home alone. Through friends, we learned of a recent litter of Dachshund Basset Hound puppies. Buttercup was the last of her litter to be adopted, and we're so grateful that she's ours. As a puppy, Buttercup wanted to play with Peanut around the clock, and he would, sometimes. But most often, they were yin and yang, high energy and low energy. High maintenance and low maintenance. Still, they forged a bond. Once, while we were on vacation without the dogs, we boarded them for a week. Buttercup did just fine, but Peanut seemed to suffer from PTSD. He needed doggy Xanax for about a week after that, and so we resolved to never board him again, unless we absolutely had to. In October of 2021, with our trip to Florida looming, we asked good friends and fellow dog owners if they'd be willing to watch Peanut and Buttercup. To our joy, they agreed. And so we left for Florida, knowing our babies were in good hands. While away, our friend sent us pictures and videos of the dogs, and Peanut looked happy. Back to that fateful day. It was actually the penultimate day of our vacation. After the birthday shindig, my phone buzzed. It was one of our sitters, who's known to be somewhat of a joker. He told me that Peanut had escaped through their backyard fence and was on the loose. I seriously had to ask, "Are you joking?" His response was grave. "No, I'm not joking. We're looking for him right now." Peanut had only been missing for an hour or so at that point. I wish I could say we weren't worried. Being Christians, we prayed. Prayed that our friends would find Peanut safe and sound. Due to the 3-hour time difference and having to catch our flight early the next morning, we went to bed. I remember my wife bursting into tears at the thought of Peanut being lost in the cold that night. In the morning, we headed to the airport in Orlando. I turned to Toni-Joy and said, "No matter what happens, our friends deserve our grace. You know it was an accident. And if the situation was reversed, we'd be guilt-ridden. Honestly, that was hard to do, and I can't take any credit for it either. It's only because I've received an unfathomable amount of grace that I'm able to give any." On the plane, I texted our loved ones back home, asking if they could help search for Peanut. By the time we arrived in the Bay Area, again, due to the time difference, the search party was still active in the neighborhood. So we joined in, borrowing our friends' bikes to canvass the area and call out Peanut's name.
Peanut! Peanut!
As much as we longed for a joyful reunion, we didn't find him. In the following days, all we could think of was to continue searching, boots on the ground. We made makeshift flyers and alerted everyone on social media. We even got in touch with a dog recovery expert. She gave us a lot of tips, some of which sounded counterintuitive, but we were already desperate. If you Google lost dogs, the internet will tell you that most of them are found, a high percentage in fact. So we always held out hope. In addition to continuing the search, Toni-Joy and I began to take turns spending the night at our sitter's house. The dog recovery expert claimed that a lost dog will eventually return to the place it went missing, even if that place isn't their home. Our friends, the sitters, lived about 45 minutes away from us, and of course we both had to work during the day. You can imagine the stress that created, not just for us, but for our friends having to host us every night for a month. 1 month. That's how long we were able to do the sleepovers before it became too stressful for everyone. And still, there was no sign of Peanut. In the meantime, we began receiving calls and texts. Usually, they were from friendly tipsters. However, every time we tracked down a lead, it turned out to be a dog that looked like Peanut. Not Peanut. We also got scam calls, like this guy with a thick foreign accent who wanted eBay gift cards in exchange for Peanut, or else he'd kill him. We got prank calls, mostly from kids. And we also got crazy calls, like this one.
"I hate you and your family. Your dog's dead.
LOL.
Can we go bathwater? Over and out."
Of course, That's a hazard of putting your phone number out there for the world to see. Eventually, we started screening calls. But I'd like to mention the strangers, yes, strangers, who are out there searching for Peanut and sending us messages like this. One little girl and her father even went door to door to distribute flyers in their entire neighborhood. Just a reminder that there are still good-hearted people in the world. Even though Peanut disappeared with his collar on and had a microchip, which is not the same as a GPS locator, we combed shelters and paid to alert veterinary offices. Honestly, the only thing we didn't do was hire a bloodhound to track Peanut's scent, because there simply wasn't any kind of service like that anywhere near the Bay Area. We, and I'm including friends and family, searched high and low for Peanut, even extending the search area by miles. And we'll always be grateful to those loved ones. But as the days turned into weeks and then months, attrition was bound to occur. Eventually, it was just a few stragglers searching, sometimes the same areas over and over, and following up on random tips. Now, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that losing a dog is the same thing as losing a child, but it hurts a lot, and it's easy to fall into the abyss. For the first time in my life, I started eating my emotions. With the holidays approaching, we made a last-ditch effort to recover Peanut by going against the dog recovery expert's advice and offering a $5,000 cash reward. Still, no luck. Eventually, I had to resign myself to waiting for news. It wasn't easy, but there was an emotional toll to continue searching and searching and searching with no success. Toni-Joy and I thought that adopting another dog might help nudge us back toward the light. And if Peanut were to return to us miraculously, like we hoped he would, then we'd just be a crazy dog family. And that suited us just fine. We went to a local shelter, this time Jelly's Place in San Pablo, California, and fell in love with this guy, Noodles. Of course, as another Chihuahua, he reminded us a little of Peanut. But his personality, high energy, protective, affectionate, was completely different. And having Noodles around did help us, and help Buttercup, who had been showing signs of doggy depression.
Happy Halloween from Indiana Bones. Buttercup the hot dog.
After owning Noodles for a brief time, we just couldn't imagine how he was found in the streets and no one ever came looking for him. Because at the very same time, we had been desperately searching for our boy, Peanut. In the fall of 2022, we decided to buy a trailer and see the nation, fulfilling a travel dream. If Peanut was found, we'd hop on the next flight home from wherever we were and get him. On February 2nd, 2023, while we were in Arizona, I got a call from a tree service worker who said he'd found Peanut's collar in the area he went missing. After so long, with so little news, we were grateful to hear something. Even this. It gave us hope that maybe someone had taken Peanut and ditched his collar. That, to us, was better than the alternative. So I called our friend who lives in the area and asked her if she could retrieve Peanut's collar. She readily agreed. A short time later, my phone buzzed again. It was our friend, and she was in tears. She said that the tree service worker didn't want to be the one to break the news to us. Peanut's remains were found with his collar. Way back in 2021, we received a tip that a chihuahua matching Peanut's description was seen very close to where his remains were found. At that time, we performed nightly stakeouts, since the dog recovery expert said that frightened dogs travel at night. Our friends also patrolled the area diligently, and this is the exact same area, in fact, where flyers were distributed to every single home in the neighborhood. The only animals we saw were cats and raccoons, but coyotes and mountain lions are by no means foreign to the area. Was it actually Peanut who was spotted then? I think it's likely. So why didn't we receive more sightings? He probably didn't last very long. We had Peanut's remains cremated, and the plan was to scatter his ashes at Patrick's Point in Northern California, where we had taken him camping with us before. However, when we picked him up from the crematorium, we saw that they had placed his ashes in a lovely container. So, we decided to take our boy with us on the road. Even now, if I think about Peanut for too long, it makes me cry. Losing our boy introduced us to a new kind of emotional suffering, and we pray it never happens to the millions of pet owners out there. Understand, when you treat your dog as more than a pet, as a legitimate member of the family, as a fur baby, when they leave you, the hurt is far greater. But the time they spent with you, the life they gave you, is far more rewarding. Again, Peanut was a pandemic dog, and we like to say we didn't rescue him. Peanut rescued us.
Bubby, my boy.